Right. Good afternoon, everybody. Great you can all join us. We're just worried about Zoom technical hitches, but so far so good. I'm Simon Andrews. I'm hosting and moderating this event. My partners at Blis, big thanks to them for their support in putting this together. We're going to run it in the Chatham House rules, so you can't ascribe something stupid that I've said to Simon Andrews, but we can quote from there. And really what we wanted to do was just take an hour of your time today to talk about what is a hot topic for our industry right now, the privacy, the IDFAs, ATT, cookies, et cetera, et cetera. I'm going to run through a small number of charts first just to set the scene. Then we've got a fantastic panel. We've got Morys from Mindshare. What, do you want to introduce yourself, Morys?
Yeah, hi. Hey guys. So I'm Morys Ireland. I lead the data and technology team Mindshare in the UK.
Sophie, do you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. So I'm Sophie and I head up the display and social departments at Wavemaker UK.
Great. And Andrew?
Hi, everyone. I'm Andrew Sandoval. I'm the VP of Biddable Media at Croud, based in New York.
So it's relatively early for Andrew. So look, Let's get started. We've got about an hour of your time. Aim to finish just after four. We've been calling this the Ad Tech Perfect Storm for about a year and a half now. I have an event planned for this time last year to talk about all these changes, and COVID sort of prevented that from happening. A year on, we're still facing the same issues, a lot going on. But a friend of mine was sort of a bit dismissive of the idea of a perfect storm. He said it's a storm in a teacup. The only people who really care about this are sort of, geeky ad tech people. It doesn't really affect the real world. And I wanted to sort of disagree with that. So if you think about the world's biggest companies are now advertising companies. So Google makes 90% of the money from advertising. Facebook make a huge portion of the money from the advertising. Amazon is believed now make more profit from their advertising business, which grew 77% in the first quarter than they did from retail. And Apple will talk about, soon to have some ambitions as well. So it's a big business. It affects lots of things. So we haven't seen the advertising trinity. Ads matter to brands because you put your Colgate or IBM or Toyota, the way you tell people about your new products is advertising. If you're a maker of content, a distributor of content in the media and entertainment world, you make your money from advertising. And people learn where they should buy the new Colgate toothpaste or get a McDonald's or a Toyota through advertising as well. So it does drive a huge amount of the industry. And the things we're talking about today have consequences for this, and we should think about that. So let's just run through some of the things that are going on in this space. We'll do this quite quickly. But the ICO is resuming their investigation into ad tech. It's been on hold for a year because of COVID. But the basic premise seems to be they don't believe that much of the programmatic world is can work under with GDPR rules, and they're threatening to actually start some investigations. They've got a bunch of new friends now because the government's taking ad tech rather more seriously than they have done before. So there's now the Competition and Markets Authority are looking at digital, Ofcom are looking at digital, as well as the ICO. And there's a group called the Digital Regulation Cooperation Forum at the heart of government are now looking at these issues as well. Business. We've also seen that Facebook have taken to press advertising to talk about their views on privacy and how it's a bad thing for small businesses. They bought ads across the quality newspapers in the UK and the States, tell their story. So here's a Blis data I want to talk about. So what they're seeing is that the number of people opting in is rather better than the flurry figure they're seeing. Because one of the things that we don't understand yet is how many apps have served, have asked the question really, of whether people are going to permit this or not. We know that Facebook have, they've been running a sort of a pre-prompt before you see the actual login on the iOS. We know that Amazon and Google haven't asked anybody, for instance, and that could be because they're very confident that the data that they've got in terms of first-party data is enough. Or we think a lot of people are waiting to see what's the best approach to try and work out how to ask that question and you know who gets success. You can't go back and ask again once you've asked already. And this is what this is the Facebook prompt screen. So they tell you you're on iOS 14.5. They tell you how one of the great things it allows you to keep Facebook free of charge, which is obviously you know, interesting selling point. And then they ask you if you want to give permission to track or not from there. I think one of the things to remember is that the actually the environment that the cookies have facilitated isn't always great. The experience on mobile and desktop web is you know, lots of ads in lots of different places. It's quite overwhelming, and you can see why people would rather see less advertising. And Apple are actually recruiting people now for their advertising team. And one thing that's a year almost to the day since ISBAR came out with the report they did on the programmatic advertising world, and you might remember that one of the findings from this was that 15% of the revenue was disappearing. They couldn't work out where it was coming from. And a year on, we haven't seen a huge amount of progress, public progress in how that's been dealt with. But one of the consequences, I think, of the third-party cookies disappearing is things like you know, the long tail of media buying that was taking place. One of the participants in the ISBA study was buying across 40,000 websites. And of course, you can't do that if you haven't got third-party cookies allowing you to track from there. So we think there's some reason for optimism. And the way we look at this is actually glass half full. You know, things have to change. There are ways of doing things rather better. And it's a time to look at what we can do better rather than worry about what's happened in the past. So that one stops screen sharing. And we're going to open up discussion. So we've got three people who are real practitioners on the agency side, and we've got Kate with us as well, who's from Blis, who runs product there. And we really want to talk about these changes. What's the effect we're seeing right now? We've had cookies missing from Safari for some time, but still being available on Chrome. We've got the recent changes in with the Facebook and the early days of you know people signing in, giving permission through the ATT. So if you start with Morys, what are you seeing right now? How's your work changed in the past few weeks?
Oh, I think we're in a bit of a holding pattern at the moment, aren't we? So it feels like simultaneously everything and nothing is happening, which is a little bit confusing because you know, there's been a lot of hype, particularly in the last 6 months as all of these announcements have come out. But many of the things that you know, are going to affect our campaigns and our activity of course here are either yet to land or they're sort of only just coming in. So you mentioned the iOS 14.5 changes that happened a week before last. So, you know, that'll probably take 6 to 8 weeks before we actually start seeing the impact of that filter through. So, you know, really where we are at the moment is preparation mode, I think. You know, we have some deadlines coming up. We have, you know, cookies going away at the end of this year, supposedly. That's the timeline we're all working to. And so, you know, where we are at the moment is basically explore new ways of working, testing and learning. And you know, there's less of an impact immediately on what is going on right now. But you know, we're using this time wisely, so to speak, with cookies still around, to be able to do some testing, comparison of the new techniques that are emerging.
Okay. And Sophie, are you in a similar holding pattern, or?
Feels like iOS 14.5. Was literally all we could speak about for weeks and weeks and months. And as he said, it's landed and it's kind of like, oh, okay. But I agree, I don't think we'll see the impact on that for a while, particularly as I haven't actually upgraded to the latest software myself, which I'm sure many on the call haven't because I haven't been forced to yet. But I would say on our side, we're doing a lot of work to try and work out where our dependency lies. And I think there's a lot of hype around certain types of targeting capabilities that are going to be more important next year. There's a lot of conversation around how measurement's going to evolve. And I think right now, as it stands, it's just trying to navigate where the pressure points really, truly are going to be, because there are going to be areas which are incredibly disrupted by the changes that have come into effect as of a couple of weeks ago and are coming underway later in the year. And then there are going to be areas that probably aren't as impacted, that we maybe haven't been on as reliant on as we suspected. So yes, that's where we are. Not a lot of change yet, but I'm personally feeling very optimistic about the changes and what that will bring over the next few months.
Let's come back to that in a second. But Andrew, what about you? Are you seeing any more action now, or are you still in the holding pattern as well?
Yeah, so I think I'd echo what both Morys and Sophie said in terms of kind of the uncertainty of holding on for iOS 14.5 to actually arrive, because I feel like every week we're like, wait, is this going to be the week? Is this going to be the week? You know, late April, kind of kept going. I think the one thing we have seen, though, is just in terms of preparation. I think Facebook was really good with their communication in terms of what we could expect to see, the steps we should be taking. And the one thing that led to was, you know, was the way we, most of our clients and the way we thought about attribution windows within Facebook. So a lot of our, some of our clients did have to make changes. Some of them were already on a one-day view, one-day click. So it really didn't affect them. But that led to material changes in our results and our reporting, you know, over the last, say, probably like number of months now that we knew these changes were coming. So it even before 14.5 happened, we already made those changes and we're kind of reacting and getting used to what that looks like. Because after 14.5, it really didn't seem like anything beyond one click, one view really made any sense based on the new guidelines handed down from Facebook, what would be recorded and what wouldn't in that. So I think that's probably been the most material change that we've seen so far.
Okay, I think we'll come back to that in a second because that's quite interesting. But I want to ask Kate as well. Kate, we didn't ask you to introduce yourself, so my apologies. But Kate from Blis is head of product there. So do you want to talk about what you're seeing? Because the data Aaron's been sharing has been quite interesting. We just saw a glimpse of that. Do you just want to talk about what you've seen so far from your side of the equation?
Yes, of course. So, I mean, since it's been 2 weeks since the iOS 14.5 has become available, and I don't know if you have seen the full stats from Blis, but we are roughly seeing that only 4% of bids are that we see across the whole iOS only comes from this new version. So that definitely indicates that Apple has quite sophisticated strategy, how they decided to roll this out. As Sophie said, she's been not exposed to the new version. So definitely consumers are taking their own choice as well. The opt-in rates that we see definitely vary per markets. A top line is that we see bid requests appearing with identities about 50% of the time in the US, which definitely indicates that the US publishers has been sort of the leaders in terms of introducing that consent pop-up. We see around 27% opt-in rates in the UK and 36% overall. That has been the newest stat. So yeah, I guess these statistics are quite good, definitely good for Blis. It indicates that is a strong baseline of opt-in personal data. And as the sort of the rollout is, or the consumers are installing the new version, we sort of expect this increase. But also that also means even though the rate is higher than what we expected, it is still significant enough that the vendors in the industry will have to adjust the ways of how they target, measure, and generally how they operate in the industry.
Okay, it's interesting. Apple's normally quite good at getting their iOS updates done quite quickly. If you compare them to Android, they normally do in a matter of days, and Android take, you know, weeks. They don't seem to be pushing it quite as hard this time. So, you know, it's playing out in slow motion. But the point you make there, Kate, about impacts, one of the figures we saw from Eric Seufert was he was forecasting that 7% of Facebook revenue was at risk by this, which was obviously a huge headline because Facebook's so big. But then Facebook, you know, grows at 25% a quarter anyway. So is it really that much impact? Andrew, you talked about seeing in attribution. Are you seeing spending patterns change on Facebook at the moment?
I think among our clients, some of them, there's been just a realignment of expectations, I would say. There's been a pretty, your mileage varies depending on what you were looking at previously and then what you switched to, how hard that effect was. And of course, how many view through conversions and how many click conversions you were getting. But certainly for some, it's been like a pretty linear progression of CPA or whatever your cost per conversion is increasing as we've switched the windows and kind of gotten used to it. It plateaus, after you get used to the new. I'd say if we switched it 2 months ago, there was a little bit of a learning curve as it switched. And then it kind of, we got to the new numbers we can expect from the new look back windows are. And now we're watching it very closely with IDFA actually going into, with the deprecation going into effect, what is actually going to happen now? Is that going to get even, is that going to move even further up to like a new plateau? Or are we going to be able to sustain this? So I think that's something we're watching really closely. And we're also watching our audience sizes. I think those are the two things that we're kind of tracking on a daily basis. Just making sure that if there is any fluctuation in audience, that we'll pick it up pretty quickly if people are opting out. We haven't seen anything so far. I think to all the points being said, it seems like it's rolling out pretty gradually. So there has been no perceptible, one day we had 500,000 in audience, the next day we had 450. We haven't seen anything like that so far.
Okay, great. So Morys, what's quite interesting, obviously this is happening in slow motion. We've been anticipating the Google changes for next year, but because Safari dropped cookies a while back, so iOS mobile traffic has been sort of affected by this. Have you seen much in the past that's less money going into iOS mobile because of that, or prices changing?
Definitely seen impacts on stats from iOS. Yeah, so you can actually plot over time stats from say something like a client's Google Analytics on conversions. And you can plot those moments when ITP came in 2018, and then ITP 2.0, and all the rest of it, and you can see the stats change. You can see how iOS suddenly drops out and you get a ton more equal amount more conversions coming through direct traffic. So you can see how it's kind of affected things over time. And yes, if someone is heavily DR focused, obviously if there is a need to ensure there's tracking in place, then you're gonna have to switch. Particularly if you want any level of kind of post impression or anything like that, then you can have to switch to some other kind of device or browser to track that. But I think what we have seen there really over the last couple of years is actually people moving to post-click tracking anyway. The idea that you could track accurately post impression, which was always a little bit kind of broken anyway. It was not exactly 100% accurate, was it, post impression attribution, occasionally misleading. And so, what we've seen is people moving towards website analytics and last click attribution, such that actually when these changes are coming, they're kind of in a good place because they're used to working in that mentality now anyway. And of course that puts things like display in a completely different light because, that totally changes your attribution and display. But if you get used to that way of working, if you get used to the fact that the numbers are dramatically different, then these changes coming up from an attribution perspective are perhaps not going to be as much of an impact as we might think.
Okay. Sophie, is relying on clicks, is it a step backwards for us? We thought clicks feel like something's been around for 20 years and sort of slightly discounted, but is it back now? Is it our best metric?
No. I think we say it's like looking back to the old with a sprinkle of new. I think you're going to have a number of, there's never going to be one source of the truth and one metric that gives you all the answers. So it's going to be a combined approach, which I don't think is new news to the industry. So there is going to be signals that we can use in channel to optimize. And I think we'll see measurement solutions in platforms evolve, as we've seen with things like server-to-server integrations coming out, moves to the click ID only, for example. But you'll probably see clients begin to invest again in older tactics like econometrics. I think we'll see a rise in regional testing to start to understand the true impact of media investment in various channels. I think positively, this is why I think it's a good change. We are really forced to kind of go down the route of there is not one source of truth when it comes to attribution. So you need to use the right tool for the right technique. And I think that will be how the industry evolves. And that's where you'll see the clients that grow the most kind of lean on as an approach versus relying solely on kind of click and click ID solutions.
Okay. The 28-day attribution, Facebook moved away from it. But to me, it always felt like a nonsense that you saw a little banner on the bottom of your Daily Mail on your phone. You can hardly read it. And 28 days later, should you happen to actually buy the product that's mentioned there, you know, you attribute it back to there. So it's been a little bit simplistic in the past. And maybe we need sort of smarter ways of thinking going forward. Kate, from your point of view, when you look at measuring campaigns, are you seeing, do you anticipate seeing things very differently going forward?
Yes, definitely. I mean, we are blessed, focus, we use location as sort of the intent as well as the main point of conversion. So we were focusing on making sure that our footfall methodology, the measurement of conversions into store has been aligned and has been sort of prepared. So we made sure that we look at what is deterministically available in the ecosystem and use the other signals that are available to see the full picture. So definitely there's been an impact, but we've been transitioning to this new way of measurement since last year. So we are feeling pretty confident. But generally what I wanted to add to what Sophie said as well is I think in general as brands, agencies, we as vendors, we will have to rethink how we measure the campaign, right? I believe that this change will actually made us think harder in what actually matters as a result of the advertising. Eventually brands care about the consumers getting to know about their brand, purchasing their product. So focusing on metrics only is probably not very sustainable. So we need to rethink as an industry, I think, how we look at this holistically and see what drives impact. It might not be as accurate or as precise or deterministic as we would want, but we still have enough. We still believe there is enough data for us to get that measurement and say what actually works better versus the other techniques.
Okay, I mentioned this before, it's a little bit bee in my bonnet, but the idea that you can buy across 40,000 websites and have, you know, a really sort of good idea of what that's doing for you, but third-party cookies enable you to do that. Here's someone we've seen on the FT, we'll follow them around wherever they end up. And one of the ones that mentioned in as well was a site selling prayer mats or something like that or whatever. So, yeah, we're going to sort of lose some of those, the volume, what quantity, and I'll hopefully move back to sort of quantity, I think, quality rather, which would be rather better. So, right, before we move on, we have to introduce a little bit of lighten the spirit a little bit. So we wanted to talk about, if you remember room 101, the program on TV, you banish things you dislike very much. And one of the things we're trying to avoid is talking too much jargon, too many three-letter acronyms, etc. from here. So that's a panel, you know, if you could get rid of one piece of buzzwords or jargon from our world, what would it be? And Morys, let's start with you.
Oh gosh, well, there's, you know, as if the space wasn't complicated enough, for some reason everyone has started to use all of these kind of sort of bird-based acronyms for everything that is going on at the moment. Now you've got flock, fledge, cowbirds, turtle dove, gnat catcher or something as well, parakeet, parrot with three R's. I can't remember the rest, but yeah, they're still getting very confusing. And, you know, it's hard enough to keep up with this stuff the best of times. But I don't know, maybe we need some slightly more descriptive names. One thing that actually, you know, keeps coming up a lot, which is reminding me a lot of GDPR, is privacy by design. That's really getting annoying. Like everything is privacy by design now, which kind of makes you think that what we're doing up to date has been kind of invasive by design or something like that. I'm not sure. It's almost like GDPR, where everyone said, okay, our solution is going to be 100% compliant. You know, don't worry, it's all going to be 100% compliant. You know, now the new buzzword is our solution is privacy by design. But, you know, you get into it, actually, you know, that's quite a debatable subject. And a lot of it is kind of legally and compliance sort of untested, if you like. So, yeah, the acronyms and the privacy by design would be ones for me.
Okay, good. Sophie?
I just find it really odd the way we just take a full word and we just, like third-party cookie, we just go around and say 3PC and expect the world to understand what that means, which obviously we do, but not everyone is as up to speed. Or 1PD, first-party data, 2PD. It would be nice to get back to the full word of just generally in acronym land, because I don't think we can go a sentence in media land, particularly without throwing out an acronym, even shortened partner names where we can, FB, IG, TW.
I agree with that. I heard something talk yesterday, and suddenly rather than CAC, customer acquisition cost, it's now CAC. So there was new words out of acronyms, which are, what's CAC again? Yeah. Andrew, what do you think was American flavor?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with everything we said. And I was actually thinking about that, the acronym piece before this, even things like using an acronym for a category of things and then specific items like IDFAs and MAIDs and obviously TTV and that whole landscape is like a nightmare of acronyms. And I feel like every week I have a discussion with somebody about what CTV, OTT, like what is everything? What does it actually mean? And certainly the birds of the privacy sandbox is awful. It's just so hokey at this point. I think going even a step further, I think we're all sick of this with COVID, but new normal, so sick of it. But really like cookie future proof in terms of like not using cookies, you know, in terms of, you know, a future proof tracking solution or targeting solution. And it's, you know, course it's not future proof. You know, flock was future proof until everyone else said they weren't going to use it. So I think that is like I think future proof is my latest kind of pet peeve on all these solutions. That's great timing.
Gotta really try not to use the word future proof now.
Sorry.
Yeah. If you can, you know, you're making a big promise if you've got it. So if you're that confident, then by all means, go for it. So,
audience, if you've got some extra ones, put it into the chat and tell us which ones you're missing as well. But Kate, will you need to build on what we've heard before? Are you a fan of birds acronyms?
No, not at all. I think from all of the industries I came across, this one is the one that's overloaded with acronyms. But I think just to sort of underscore what Andrew said, I think the identifiable user is probably another one, not something that I would like to see banished, but something that we'll have to forget, be forced to forget. So yeah, that's the one I would add to the list.
Michaelis points out that we're past the year of mobile, which is good. It happened about five times, I think, whatever. I think one of the problems I always have with the jargon is often designed not to explain something, but almost to cover up the fact that you're talking about something that maybe you don't know quite as much about, or trying to pull the wool over someone's eyes. People don't always like to say, just a minute, explain that to me again. The buzzwords have a problem. So let's get back into the issues then. We know we're in a holding pattern. We know that, it looks very likely that this change is going to be significant in terms of the numbers of people who are available to us to do the things, the tracking we've done from there. So do you want to talk about, you've been planning for a while, thinking about this. What do you think how do we mitigate this going forward? What do you think the new strategies will be? We've touched upon it a little bit already on attribution, et cetera. Morys talks about that. But Morys, let's talk with you. What do you think going forward now, what are you advising clients to be sort of preparing to do, recognizing that, a large chunk of what was possible to do before is no longer possible?
Yeah, so as we said, the timeline's potentially a little bit fluid. We don't know if when Google says they're going to be deprecating third-party cookies by 2022. We don't know if that means, end of this year, or if it's going to slip a little bit or whatever. But what we're advising clients to do is really just to prepare as if, that is absolutely going to happen, because it is going to happen at some point. The writing is on the wall, just like it's going to happen, in the mobile space with Android IDs. It's going to be happening then.
Yeah.
Soon, pretty soon too. So, if you're preparing for iOS today, then what you're going to do there is going to be applicable for Android tomorrow. So really what we're looking to do with each client, and what we've been doing over the course of this year, is just auditing, ensuring that we understand all of the different strategies that every client depends on, that they use, and that are affected by any of these changes going on, be it a tech change, industry change, etc. And aiming by the end of this year, through testing and learning and engaging with different vendors, so you have a plan in place for next year. So each one of those strategies, we should have an alternative that we can go to come 2022, at least one alternative ideally, that we've tested and that we understand a little bit about, maybe not everything, but at least something about, in terms of how it might affect our benchmarks, our outcomes, and all the rest of it. And it's not easy in many cases, because as you kind of alluded to earlier, not all of these use cases have particularly good solutions right now. So frequency capping and display looks kind of like we're going to be doing that only within one share, and sort of based on that publisher's data. It's not really the same as frequency capping across all of our display activity. So it's not kind of the answer that we want, really, but it's something. It's probably better than no frequency capping, and similar for attribution. So, for each of these things, attribution, retargeting, data targeting, all of this stuff, we're coming up with tests over the next few months and building that into activation plans for next year.
Okay. Andrew, how about you?
I feel like echoing a lot of what Morys said, but I guess we're all kind of doing the same processes, but very much on the same page in terms of client by client, really auditing what they do. Think of the implications in, I think, three different ways is how I think about it. What are the audience targeting implications? What are the measurement implications? And what are the optimizational impacts that could come away with there being less cookies? They're all pretty tied together, but if measurement's going to be impacted, and obviously the data that we're using to optimize is going to be impacted. So how do we basically plan around that? I think kind of the theme overall, though, is the idea of first party data, which is kind of its own buzzword at this point, because it's been harped on so much since the deprecation of cookies was announced. But I think traditionally we've thought of first party data in terms of tracking, and audiences and remarketing audiences and building up your CRM. And it certainly means that. But I think what it's the kind of through line from some things people mentioned earlier was, it's really about your first party business data, understanding your business outcomes and getting more comfortable optimizing to your business outcomes and the conversion data you own, let's say your sales data, versus relying on any platform to give you that. And I think that's been, it's for some advertisers, that's a big shift, especially those who were doing a lot of tracking in say Facebook and really relying on platform numbers, because the walled garden of Facebook made it really hard to get them into, you know, the other ecosystems or the other measurement frameworks. So I think that's one of the biggest things we've done is like helping clients feel confident in the way they're tracking media to their business outcomes, whether that's in GA or, you know, even in their first party sales, and then making media decisions based on that, which is a little bit different than in the past where it was, you know, Google Ads says X, put more money in Google Ads, you know? So I think it's getting more comfortable using that data for media optimizations.
Okay, Sophie?
It's a very similar approach shock. But I think one of the other things that I've been spending a lot of the time doing with the team is actually working closely with the partners as well. It's so important that we're working hand in hand to feedback on solutions, provide a view of exactly kind of what we're needing to see as well. And that has been something we've been kind of working on for a kind of number of months with kind of key partners where we know there is that reliance on third-party cookies. So one of the first things we did was just work out at an agency level what percentage of, for example, display strategies were reliant on third-party cookies by various partner, to then work out, right, what are the testing opportunities we need to go about doing and how do we need to evolve how we're working with this partner in particular. So it's kind of two-pronged. We can assess the kind of dependency from a client's perspective, but we have to assess the dependency our partners have and work with them to build solutions, because the industry is only going to keep going if we all work together. So that's kind of been a big focus for us, is working hand in hand with our clients and our partners on the solutions to address dependency on all sides.
Let me build on that, though. So there's a talk that, you know, this is a good thing for the walled gardens, because when things are tough, the people who've got all the first party data is Google, it's Facebook, it's Amazon, etc. From there, I'm not looking for a headline here, or you know, but yeah, you know, do you think you're going to see money shifting from, you know, some partners to other partners who are better prepared for this? You know, is this where you're going to shift from the 40,000 long tail to the premium publishers, Ozone, for instance? How do you sort of see that? I know it's early days yet, but how do you envisage that playing out?
It's a tricky one, because I think some clients will head, I don't want to say the word flock, but will head in the direction of certain partners. But you'll have other clients that are kind of willing to test and want to be the first to market for certain new solutions, which might not be with those big partners. And one of the things that I've really enjoyed seeing is actually some of the collaboration that's happening amongst some of the partners. So if you look at some of the changes in the publisher world, and you look at solutions like Ozone, which has obviously been around for a while now, but actually how they're changing the model slightly to work with the publishers from a direct and then kind of programmatic perspective, I think you'll see more of those alliances pop up, which means that actually that reliance on the kind of larger walled gardens won't necessarily be as great. So we all, it's no secret, ID solutions rely on the industry working together to scale. So hopefully what we'll see is kind of more collaboration, which leads to less kind of necessarily dependency on one or two solutions, because I think the truth of the matter is there isn't going to be one answer, particularly not at the moment. So it's going to be critical that we test and learn everything we can over the next few months to understand what is going to deliver the best outcomes for each and every client and brand.
And Kate, as sort of one of the partners, you know, you're involved in those conversations, I guess, as well. Do we all buy that idea that there's going to be a number of different alternatives to, you know, maybe, you know, third-party cookies is one thing, we know how that works really well. We're now going to have four or five different things happening. It's going to be more complicated to get to a similar sort of place from there.
Yes, I think just to underscore everything that Sophie said as well, I think we as an industry will have to find a solution, because as some of the bigger partners, they are introducing something that they say is going to work. It has 95% accuracy. You know, we need to ask questions, and I'm happy to hear that the other guys from the agency side are probing these questions, because they're really important. So, I mean, as Blis as a vendor here, we definitely have this advantage of owning and operating our own tech stack, which allows us to, we make the buying decisions based on the data that we see. So that's definitely a huge advantage, because this industry tended to be created of companies that are also quite modularized, I guess. So it's using someone else's technology. So the Awesome project definitely is a great example of how this can be mitigated. So definitely asking questions will be important, and uncovering how things work. Definitely when there is a lot of chaos in any situation, right? This industry is a great example, but there can be a lot of companies coming to surface that will, with chaos, there can be a lot of fraud, right? So someone can come and say, we have this miracle solution that's gonna work. So as vendors who will work with these companies, as well as the agencies and brands, is important to understand how everything works. So we need to keep educating ourselves, educate the rest of sort of the whole ecosystem. We need to know what's going on.
Yeah, I think that one of the things I feel very positive about or hopeful about is, you know, as money moves towards people who have good first party data, and it rewards well-run businesses. You know, I think it's tragic that you look at the Telegraph, the Guardian, the Times, et cetera, even New York Times, and you see terrible ads because they're just, you know, really unprogrammatic. Whereas the paper, you know, someone's decided, if I've got BMW, I'll talk to the smart people that read the Financial Times. You know, you don't see that carry through to the digital sometimes. And I think also what fascinates is to look at people like Walmart, ASOS, you know, building out, you know, advertising solutions for verticals, so they can use their first party data, and you can actually get very narrow from that. But we are into something, there's 5 or 10 things you're doing rather than just one bite from there. So let's talk about the tools then. So Flock, you know, Turtle Dove, etc. From there, there's, you know, interesting that Wired had a headline that it's in disarray. They found that they can't run it in Europe because it might not comply with GDPR, etc. What do we think? Obviously, Google shaped the weather to a large extent here. Do we think that Google will come up with something that's going to be acceptable in due course? Or is the jury still out?
Yeah, I think the jury is still out, isn't it? It's really interesting to see how Google, having unlocked this kind of Pandora's box by saying they're going to deprecate cookies in Chrome, presumably thought they could sort of dictate the agenda of what the replacement would be, but had to kind of, you know, give a bit of a nod to the industry by making that privacy sandbox umbrella initiative more open than simply just a Google-led initiative. But what we're seeing is that, you know, some of the alternatives that have been proposed in there, already people are coming out and saying that they simply won't support them, from tech vendors to publishers. So having unlocked this Pandora's box, they actually haven't, you know, for once yet been able to dictate where the industry is going to go with it yet. Anyway, we will see. Obviously, if they do start to push a solution that they find is going to be compliance and all the rest of it, then, you know, I dare say that's going to get a bit of traction. But certainly we see, you know, a bit of tension between this kind of cohort-based mentality that Google is pushing with Flock and with other similar initiatives, and then this sort of one-for-one tracking mentality, which the likes of the universal ID types are pushing on the other side, who are saying that, you know, one-for-one tracking is totally fine, it's, you know, as long as it's consent. You know, that's the important point, that it's consent tracking. Yeah. So yeah, it's going to be interesting to see those wins out. I'm thinking it's going to be more the cohort-based scenario than the one-for-one track scenario.
I imagine Google watching the Facebook, you know, situation play out just as much as we are, because they want to learn what consumers feel about this, what they want to do from there. It's interesting that they announced that Android would have a similar sort of policy in a sort of little blog post. They haven't made a headline about it. So it seems to be running along, you know, behind, really. And then the cohorts, it's quite interesting that if you dig around in Apple, if you read the Apple terms and conditions, that they will still serve ads to groups of 5,000. So it's a cohort by another name. So that sort of thinking seems to be reasonably widely shared, but the actual flavor of it is rather different. What about the unified IDs? There's lots of people, knowing the vendors doing this, but again, it seems to be, different people have different solutions and they're not overly compatible, and various browsers have said they won't run the, et cetera. So do we think that unified IDs have got a chance as well? Sophie, do you want to, I give you the difficult question?
I think they do. I think it's still early days in that respect. Like, they're still working through what that solution looks like. There is a huge amount of work that needs to be done to make a unified ID solution work at scale. But I think there is such kind of hope on that solution, being placed on that solution, that it will be made to work. But it comes down to this point again that people need to work together in order for it to work, and everyone needs to be comfortable with the parameters that are set in terms of how that ID is collected and distributed. So I feel positive about unified ID solutions. I just think rather than having several million solutions, we'll get down to one or two really strong solutions in the end that are scalable. But again, it relies on everyone working together. And at the moment, I just don't think we're there yet as an industry. We're still trying to muddle through. We're still asking important questions. But I suspect in a couple of months' time, actually, those solutions will look very different to how they look today, because every day something changes in the land of 3PC and iOS 14.
It does feel like there's, someone's going to act as a kingmaker here, whereas someone like with huge volume like the Trade Desk or Google say we're going to do this one, and then people will then start to gravitate to that versus something else from that. But again, the whole sort of probabilistic way that there's, some of the ideas are done. Apple will be doing that as well. If you read their right to the end of their terms and conditions, hidden away, not quite hidden away, but a long, long way down, Apple talk about they'll use your browser settings, et cetera, to work out targeting too. So
Simon, can I cut in there and
yes,
add something? Because I think you brought, both you and Sophie touched on something interesting there with unified IDs, which I think is always at the tip of my tongue, which it's about like kingmakers, and there needs to be somebody with a really strong consumer facing brand leading this unified ID solution. I feel like if we're going to get the consent buy-in that we need to make a really large solution like that possible. And I think that's, the Trade Desk is trying to lead the education on it, very much pushing all their marketing with the open web. Jeff Green's obviously out there a lot speaking about it. I think at the very beginning of everything today, you showed the slide with, consumers and like what they get out of ads. And I think selling that value prop to them is like one of the most crucial topics it's not being ignored, but it's just not being addressed. Like, some ads from the Facebook from Trade Desk aren't going to get it done, because the average consumer has no idea what the Trade Desk means and what it is. And when you think of even the brands in, at the very top in FANG, who could really sell this message? Nobody that would want to risk aligning themselves with it. Whether that's Apple or, I think Apple's probably the only one that probably has the goodwill at this point to make a play like that. And they would never, obviously their whole marketing message is away from that. So I really think the 80 unified ID solutions, that I feel like that Loomscape keeps growing, or that's the update I keep seeing in my LinkedIn, but there's another 10. I think that's what a lot of them hinge on. And if that can be a coalition where they leverage the brands, with the publisher brands to get it done, that's certainly one way of doing it. But I think that puts a lot of bonus on the brands of, the New York Times or the Guardian or whoever these publications are that are gonna have to carry water for that. And I think that's just, to me, that seems like tough sledding, especially too, if Chrome can one day come down and say, or Google can come down and say, tough luck, we're not allowing it because we don't think the tech is privacy preserving enough. So
I think Google or the regulators, to be honest, because if I was a regulator coming in, you know, from an ad tech lens, makes perfect sense. Unified IT, you know, if you look at it, they're building in a lot of privacy safe controls or some encryption, etc. But from a regulator's perspective, it's kind of, right, okay, guys, so you were sharing cookie IDs around, now you're sharing email addresses around. is this a good evolution or not? Because I just think it's almost like these universal IDs are just trying to find another way to make the existing frameworks work. And I just wonder if we need a little bit of a paradigm shift, because otherwise it feels like what generally happens in a few years' time, we'll be playing catch up again when a regulator steps in and says, actually, no, you can't do this. And you'll have to re-engineer that whole system. I think we probably need to move to something which is going to be, to use the buzzword that Andrew hates, future-proof.
Well, I think Andrew, you make a good point about someone needs to, you know, build the case for advertising, but I think we've left it too late. No one's done that, you know. And you know, you've told people, we've all seen ads that work really well. We've all seen annoying ads. The balance has shifted. And New York Times, their digital ad revenue grew by 2%, I think, last year, where everyone else grew by 50%, because they've given up on ads. They make the money from subscriptions. So what about context? Is there anything context has got a solution here? Is context part of the answer rather than the answer?
I can take that. I think it's part of the answer. Definitely the context is not the only information that tells us that can effectively tells us what consumer we are targeting. Because, you know, I regularly browse Louis Vuitton website, but I don't own any Louis Vuitton bags, right? That's probably the best example I've used over time. And it's useful. It's useful to understand what people are reading, but as a standalone solution is definitely not enough. So it will have to be combined with something else. And that's why, as sort of Sophie said, there will be a couple of strong solutions, but not one single that will solve that problem. That will make it easy for consumers to understand what's going on, as well as for all of the vendors to operate in this new world.
Thank you. So it's sort of like, yeah, like everything, the smart people are going to prosper going forward because the easy solutions are taken away. The people who do things badly are going to sort of struggle, I think, you know, because people don't like bad ads still. We've got two more sessions to run. We're running another one in June the 11th to go deeper because there's so much to talk about in this space. And it is playing out, you know, I think as Sophie and Morys said, it feels like slow motion at the moment. You know, by June the 11th, we'll have a better idea what's happening. We're going to start thinking more about that attribution point and the measurement. But someone said to me the other day, we're going to have 25 walled gardens to manage. We think it's tough now with Google and Facebook and maybe Amazon. We're going to have, like, you know, find ways of actually taking data and learning from 20 different places and putting it together. So it's back to econometric modeling. I think Sophie mentioned that. Things that are a little bit, you know, haven't really landed in digital in the way they've landed in traditional, but, you know, have some benefits when you've got so many different things to think about from here. So look, we've got a minute to go. I just want to say thank you to all the panelists for putting an hour in and some preparation, which has been really interesting. Thanks for everyone who showed up. I'm going to send a note afterwards, one with a sort of an invitation to our next event in early June, where we'll dig a bit deeper. We'll send out a bit more information about our guild. We've got a community where you can talk about these issues and debate them. Aaron from Blis will share some really good information on a regular basis about you know, the data they've been seeing. We've got lots of smart people talking from there. And there's a survey asking what we could do to improve on. Our technical skills will be you know, under some scrutiny after we can get the deck to play. But hopefully you find that useful. I think there's a lot to learn. There's so much going on. Thank you again, and we look forward to seeing you on June 11th.